Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the American Society of Clinical Pathology's 2017 annual meeting. Please turn your attentions to the screen.
Pathologists and medical laboratory professionals are at the very heart of your healthcare. They save lives every day by diagnosing your medical conditions. These scientists make 70% of all diagnostic medical decisions in healthcare. Your primary care doctor, your oncologist, your surgeon, and your child's pediatrician all rely on pathologists and laboratory professionals to make the right diagnosis at the right time so you and your family can be treated quickly and effectively. Our job is to save lives through accurate and effective diagnoses. Your health tomorrow depends on pathologists and laboratory professionals who are making an impact today. To learn more about these life-saving professionals, visit ASCP.org. Made possible through the generous support of the ASCP Foundation.
Please welcome to the stage the Chief Executive Officer of ASCP, Dr. Blair Holiday.
Well, good afternoon. I hope everybody's been having an enjoyable day. I know it's incredible electric atmosphere out there. Thanks for joining us this afternoon. Today, you are in for an extraordinary program. The video you just saw is called The Value of the Lab. Is how great of an example of promoting the laboratory to the general public and why we need to work together to make this the case. It was made possible by the ASCP Foundation. A video that's now being shown on over 4,000 flights across the United States and even in through September to 1.8 million people. And in fact, when we put it on the ASCP's Facebook page, 175,000 people 5,700 shares and 1,100 comments, and that's just within the past couple weeks. So you are the members of the medical laboratory, and you are the healthcare professionals, and you are the individuals that made this change. And this is because we believe in what we do. The foundation launched to support that virtue. Since that time, the ASCP Foundation Visibility Fund supports public relations, it supports advertising campaigns, it supports anything specific to the story of what you do and why every effort that you make is so valuable and must be understood, must be recognized by our peers, it must be recognized by our colleagues, by insurers, by the government, by the public. That foundation is your foundation, working to promote the future of the laboratory and in particular, help provide things such as scholarships. It provides an opportunity for financial support for pathology residents. It provides an opportunity for professional networking, for laboratory students, for clinical laboratory programs, for tuition, for medical laboratory program directors. It provides the opportunity to purchase education-related materials, any kind of training resource that's needed. In addition, it supports a very important initiative that we launched several years ago from the White House, and that is the ASCP-led Partners Cancer and Diagnosis and Treatment in Africa, where we are providing access to diagnostic medicine virtually throughout the continent of Africa. And while this effort has generous support of sponsors such as Philips, Pfizer, GE Healthcare, we still need more resources. We still need more support. So as we work together and individually, we're hoping that you will help us with the foundation to cover the kinds of costs associated with establishing and providing the much needed equipment that's needed for this life-saving endeavor for a billion people across the continent of Africa. You'll get an opportunity after we leave the program today to even help us in the exhibit hall at the ASCP Foundation booth. So your cash contributions are very appreciative. At this point in time, I would actually like to recognize the founding members of the founding society of the ASCP Foundation. If you would, please stand. Please continue to stand. These 14 individuals have invested in the future of our profession, the future of medical laboratory professions. Thank you again. Another great initiative this year that we launched is referred to as our Patient Champions Program. And that basically is a program where we look at the clinical care team and how pathologists on that clinical care team and how laboratory professionals in that clinical care team make the decisions, diagnose the diseases, and determine the treatment plans, but help patients understand their critical role in that treatment plan. We're working to serve our patients. As such, we must raise awareness, the critical role that we play and the laboratory plays in this particular endeavor. So the Patient Champions is real life stories. These are either current or former patients that share how they've overcome adversity, how they've overcome their disease, how they've looked into the future of their own disease and help the laboratory make its visibility known to people outside of our profession. And it's through their stories that we refer to them as patient champions that empower each of these patients to ask the right questions, understand the right treatment options, and more importantly, to spread the word to the public regarding the critical role that you play in the laboratory to their survival and bring visibility to the public. So I'd like to share with you a video of Patient Champions.
My name is Erin Carter. I'm a wife, a mother, and I've had thyroid cancer for 8 years. I was first diagnosed with cancer when I was a senior in college, and 2 weeks later I had surgery, a complete thyroidectomy, to remove my thyroid and two lymph nodes that also had cancer. Fast forward 8 years later, and I was pregnant with my son and was going to a routine follow-up appointment. She identified three questionable lymph nodes and suggested that I have another fine needle biopsy. I had given them permission to talk to my husband, Cody. He was the one that called, and he just said, "Hey, hon," and I knew. Unlike the first time I had cancer, I had more than myself to take care of. If I was giving anyone advice for someone that was going through cancer as a mother, I would suggest asking for help and really focusing on taking care of yourself. My life would be a lot different without pathologists or laboratory professionals. The whole course of my cancer treatment was dictated by all of my test results. Without that team of people, I wouldn't be where I am today.
My name is Cindy Johns, and I am a certified laboratory professional. I am also a five-time cancer survivor. You never can imagine yourself going through that and how you're going to survive it. I feel like I've beaten it for five times. I think it's really important to have a program such as this patient initiative in order to help others understand and realize that there are resources for them to go to, that there is a light at the end of the tunnel, and that they should feel empowered to be able to take charge of their own health care. I fully believe that without the laboratory, I probably would not be sitting here. What I would like people to remember is, first of all, that I was a good person, that I tried to always do the right thing, that I treated people well, and that I always dedicated myself to whatever task was at hand, whether that was working in the laboratory, doing the best you could, or volunteering in order to make someone else's life better.
Patient champions give new patients hope. They give them hope for the future. They help them with the understanding the difficult and uncertain times that they're dealing with. They help demystify the medical conditions. They help prepare the patients for what lies ahead. And they spread their love of the laboratory. And I'm pleased to present our very dear friend, Cindy Johns.
Organization, as you have heard, for 40 years, and I am continually learning more about this organization in order to be able to do as good a job as I can do. The main thing about where I am today is the fact that I've actually had two more occurrences of cancer. And so instead of being a five-time cancer survivor, now I'm up to seven. And I am hoping that the latest treatments that I have gotten are taking care of the reoccurring tumors in my brain, and also will start to treat the tumors that are in my spine. And hopefully that will take care of it, because I am getting very tired of this. I'd be very, very happy to be done with it. But you know what? You gotta do what you gotta do. And one of the things that I wanted to be able to do with my message today and with my message throughout this whole patient champions process is to make sure that people understand that they have something to back them up when they have questions, when they have issues, that their doctors are not always going to have the answers. And so we want to make sure that they've got the resources they need, and that they are able to find someone to turn to be able to get the information that they need for the diagnosis that they have received. So I am hoping that part of what I have been doing with the Patient Champions video and with the ASCP Patient Champions team, that we will be able to give them the resources and the guidance that they need in order to come out on the best side of their diagnosis. So we're going to just keep plugging away. Of course, I was not very happy when I learned that I still have tumors that need to be treated. But you know what? It is what it is. And you just have to keep plugging away and doing what you've got to do in order to address the situation that you have been placed in, you know, and there's nobody's fault. That just is one of those things. I have absolutely zero reason to be battling this fight still, but it is what it is, and we want to make sure that we continue to fight it, and that it will, you know, that it will continue to be treated and continue to be taken care of. So I am so thrilled that I have the background of a laboratory professional so that I do know what questions to ask. I do know what paths to go down, and being able to understand what's going on in the laboratory and why the diagnosis was made in the manner that it was made and why it continues to be made, I feel very fortunate to have that background and that understanding of the laboratory and of laboratory professionals and of pathologists. So that there is something that I can turn to and feel confident about when these diagnoses keep coming up. So I am very happy to be here. I thank ASCP. I thank ASCP every day that I decided to be a laboratory professional, and that I have been able to be involved in this organization and to continue to fight, I'm going to say fight the good fight. I don't think that it is over with by any means. I am not planning on that, and I keep telling Blair he can't get rid of me that easy. So we will continue to fight it out, and whenever that, you know, the end rears its ugly head, that everyone, including myself and my family, will be prepared, you know, for whatever it is that's going to be coming up. So I am thankful for all of you to be here. Thank you very much for taking the time out of your busy day, and I hope that you will be able to gain some knowledge and wisdom from the program, the Patient Champions program, that we have been working on and putting together for you and your families, because there are just so many people out there that are forced into this situation, and unfortunately they don't normally have a good way of managing it. And so our intent is to help people manage it. So
our 2017 patient champion, the one and only Cindy Johns. Very heavy. We're gonna, here, let's go over here and get a quick picture, okay?
Okay. Wait a second.
Chris Parham, around me. Here we go. Very slowly. Okay. We're gonna get it right here. You ready? Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much.
Very slowly. Maybe I can put an arm around your arm. Well done, very well done. So we're gonna move into the part of our plenary session that focuses on global health, and you're gonna have the opportunity to hear one of the true change agents in the world. In the past 10 years, however, ASCP has really diversified its portfolio, becoming a worldwide organization. We're now doing commerce and working in around 100 countries around global health, and it began when we first worked with the HIV/AIDS epidemic that started in the early 80s, but we began really fortifying efforts around 2005. So PEPFAR, or the Presence Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, is the program that really got started to combat this disease, and we work in tandem with the Centers for Disease Control, and we have worked to make sure that AIDS and tuberculosis and other diseases within Sub-Saharan Africa are eventually eliminated. Now, it's a partnership that's crucial. The laboratory plays a central role. Many of in this room have been involved in this. But the importance is the diagnosis and treatment of diseases such as HIV are critically important, and we have to continue to be vigilant. Now, our initial involvement was a public health offering or crisis within Sub-Saharan Africa. Of course, these are resource-limited countries, and they need the reliable diagnostic testing, the treatment. They need the information from us to help reduce mortality. But our goal is to leave a sustainable infrastructure. And our goal, of course, is to train the trainer and to have an opportunity to move on to the next set of diseases. So thanks to the historic success of our enormously critical program in PEPFAR, I have to say that 16 African countries have been drastically affected by reducing that rate of disease. 16 of these countries include those that you would assume that would be in Sub-Saharan Africa, but some of them are actually in Eastern Europe. Some of them are in Southeast Asia. And we're continuing to move beyond the boundaries of even Africa to other lower middle-income countries of the world. And it happens because of our consistent funding through the CDC, but our ability to expand a workforce that needs to be maintained, contained, and retained within that part of the world. To date, we're working in now 29 different countries with these training sessions. And this year alone, 6,000 laboratory professionals were trained. But today we face a new challenge. And as you know, as we discussed even last year and the year before, people are living longer with HIV/AIDS, and we're now dealing with non-communicable diseases, diseases that include cancer and cardiovascular disease. We've discussed the fact that 650,000 people a year in Africa alone die of non-communicable disease, but most of it is cancer. And of those, 95% have no access to diagnostics. So that's a very high mortality rate. By 2030, those figures are expected to increase to 1.28 million cancer cases per year. So the tragedy is that one-third of these cancer deaths are actually preventable, and one-third of them, in fact, can be detected early. And as you know, cervical cancer, breast cancer, these are the kinds of diseases that we can make an impact on early. But too many women with highly prevalent HPV have no access to Pap tests or HPV testing or VIA or any of the other kinds of intervention strategies. And of course, malignancy ensues. So the high death rate of cancer, particularly in women, is an atrocity that we all have a responsibility to overcome. Now, we know that cancer is not just a unique disease for Africa. Okay, the vast majority of the diseases or cancers we see in our own country, both here in the United States and Europe. We have abundant tools in these countries that we live in, don't we? We have access to drugs, we have access to treatment, we have access to the entire panorama of medical diagnostics. But it's not a complex particle physics or secrets of human cells that we're talking about. We're trying to transfer what we're doing here and bring treatable options to patients across the world. So we have to, in fact, establish an efficient and timely manner of making an impact, and we have to do the simple things to the complex things. Simple from finding grossing hoods, looking for tissue processors, helping buy embedding stations, microtones, cover slippers, microscopes, you name it, storage equipment, just the basic things that we work with every day. The reporting systems, the lab information systems, so the right diagnosis gets back to the right patient at the right time. So a couple years ago, we launched this initiative from the White House, and a massive humanitarian effort took place. It's at this point around $150 million of in-kind giving. And the cross-sector group of industry, nonprofits, professional societies, all working together to effectuate a change in low and middle income countries that have no access. And we use this access to you, actually our volunteers, the experts, to dovetail into our activities with the World Health Organization and all the preventable and non-controllable diseases and non-communicable diseases that we've been fighting so efficiently, but with a lot of perspiration. We need your help. We're leading this partnership now with the Clinton Global Initiative and a prestigious roster of organizations, including the CDC, as I mentioned, the WHO, but also the National Institutes of Health. But we need industry as well. Pfizer, Philips, Novartis, GE Healthcare, Sakura Fintech, all of these are organizations that step forward and say, we care, we're going to do something, we're going to help you make a difference. So while we've identified partners, it's still our major challenge to recruit partners. We need you to help us recruit partners. We need that how-to manner. We need you to help us bring the kinds of solutions to create and execute solutions. Solutions that we can all acclaim to make sure that we provide what's necessary to support cancer for our brothers and sisters around the world. It's our moral obligation. Yes, we're using leapfrog technology because it's hard to transport necessarily the standard of care in the United States to countries who have very little standard of care. So we are trying to use more innovative types of technology, but we need partners, and we need to administer this on an economical and a scalable manner. We're using cloud-based infrastructure, we're registering specimens, and we're disseminating these diagnoses across the world. And it has been incredibly successful even in the last 2 years alone. So through this commitment, our clinicians locally in Africa are able to provide treatment for diagnoses that they've never seen before, that they had never had the option to treat before. And we need more. We can't accomplish this without you. There are certain elements of this process that are absolutely critical for success. We have to have the buy-in from the ministries of health, but we have to have the buy-in from you. We have to have the buy-in from the hospitals and the health systems, but we have to have the buy-in from our volunteers. We need the buy-in from CDC Africa, African Society for Laboratory Medicine. We need more partners. We live in a world of 8 billion people that live around the world in different places, speak different languages, folks, and many, many different dialects. But none of us are immune to the same susceptibility of these diseases, these conditions, some that are old, some that are new, that affect the human race at large. Every one of us are connected to each other. There's 400 million people in this world who have no access to healthcare. 400 million. So in this interconnected world that becomes more interconnected every day, we need you. And in this modern day of travel, infectious diseases crossing borders, continents posing threats to not just our health and welfare, but to other populations that are unprepared for these kinds of diseases. We need you. And that's where we all come together. It's the changes in the development, it's the changes in the infrastructure, interpretation, communication, it's the changes in even the laboratory tests that are being offered that evolve. This is a perpetual motion. We need you. The molecular basis for diseases are changing. They're revolutionizing the profession. We need you. There are communities that are inhabiting new challenges where we have later and greater types of technologies that we can bring to local communities, bring across the globe. This leaves our legacy to the future generations around the world. We need you. Partnerships, just like the PEPFAR partnership, highly critical. So it's this PEPFAR partnership that we really like to showcase today. Partners are crucial to ensure success. I want to introduce you to one of the major partners and a true change agent for the profession. U.S. Ambassador at Large, Dr. Deborah Birx, the coordinator of the United States Government Activities to Combat HIV/AIDS. She's also the U.S. Special Representative for Global Health Diplomacy, a world-renowned medical expert, a leader in the field of HIV/AIDS, a three-decade-long career focusing on immunology, vaccine health, research, global health. She oversees the implementation of the PEPFAR, i.e., again, the U.S. President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, which, if you don't know this, is the single largest commitment by any nation to combat a single disease in the history of mankind. And it's a government-funded engagement that uses the Global Fund to fight AIDS, TB, malaria, and many other diseases. It is absolutely my distinguished pleasure to introduce to you the Ambassador, Ambassador Birx.
Wow. Thank you.
Good to see you. Good afternoon. Good to see all of you. It's really a privilege to be here and really to start with this slide to really thank you for your support. ASCP has been a partner beside us from the very beginning of PEPFAR. I've been in three different departments since PEPFAR started, first in the Department of Defense, then at the CDC, and now at the State Department. But the work that you have brought through your volunteers, and I hope you all pick this up. It is in the community of displays about the work that you're doing with global outreach and how you've translated your knowledge around the globe. So I have some little provocative pieces to start out with, and I'm coming over here because I did not wear sunglasses when I worked overseas for the last 30 years, so now I have bilateral subcapsular cataracts, so I can't really see any of you anymore. And I can barely read slides, but I just wanted to talk a little bit about change and change management as we go through different elements in our new administration, which is fundamentally incredibly supportive of PEPFAR. But people always talk about the money, and I know it probably you heard, or a $6 billion program, but it's how the money is used. And that's what's absolutely critical. It is your taxpayer dollars translated into this humanitarian program, but it's how we use your dollars and how we use your intellect that will have an impact. We also move to a very different place. We talk about outcomes and impact now. We just don't talk about counting things and what we've done. And we are better about doing the counterfactuals. Now, I tell you, the business community is great with this. They always can get the counterfactuals, like if you build that road, it's gonna mean this much more to your bottom line. Ministers of Finance love that. We have never done our counterfactuals correctly, of really showing out what that investment today means about what these diseases will be in the future and how they will be less in the future because of the investment today. Another big issue is it's not about what we spend, it's about what it should cost. And sometimes those are two very different things. And we're working on that right now within PEPFAR. We know how much we spend on things, but we don't truly know what it should cost. when you put into the lab technician time, when you put in the supply chain, when you put in getting the results back to the client and the clinician and the nurse, what should that actually cost? And it's about the disease with the people and the resources and the hydraulics of our outcomes and impacts. Now, where is the laboratory in all of this? Now, if you talk to a clinician, they'll talk about the results and the equipment. Sometimes they forget that there's people behind those pieces of equipment. So it's not about the equipment. It's about the people who run and maintain that equipment. It is about their work life. It's not about the equipment, but it's about the reagents. And did we get the reagents there to run the equipment? It's not about the equipment, but the optimal placement of equipment with the throughput and the technician time. And I know we often don't do that well. I go into some labs that have lined up 12 gene expert machines. And I was like, well, if you're running 12 simultaneously, we probably should have gotten a different piece of equipment. But those are the types of things that we have to work on together. It's not about the number, but the validity of that number. Some of you individuals that I've worked with for a long time, Jeff, we were in a lab, he probably doesn't remember, about 13 years ago in Namibia, or 12 years ago. Beautiful lab, beautiful equipment. I went through the control books, because when I go in a lab, I start opening up the refrigerator, looking at the dates on all the reagents, making sure that that's done correctly and things are dated. I go to the control books, and I looked at the controls for the fax scans. And yes, every morning they ran those controls. And every morning, they showed that those fax scan lasers were out of sync. They were not corrected. They went on and ran all of the samples. And all of those results, day after day, were wrong. They ran the controls. They followed the SOP part, but not the part about what to do when the control is out of range. And so these are the things that you help us with. This is the transmission of your knowledge. It's not about the assays, but what those assays mean. And I want to talk about a little bit about your work and what it looks like. Now, I'm going to go quickly through a bunch of slides because I want to give you an idea of where the epidemic is today. 3.5 years ago, we really changed the program to be much more around accountability. And when you talk about accountability, you have to have transparency. You can't talk about accountability unless you make your results visible and available. So if you go to PEPFAR.gov, you can see every single result down to the district level, and within the next 6 months, we'll be down to the site level, so that communities and governments can know precisely what's going on where we're serving those clients. And then we move to impact, not just a model of the epidemic, but really showing what's happening at the community level. And what have we found? Well, the good news is UNAIDS about 3 years ago, 4 years ago, came out with this model called 90-90-90. You are the 90-90-90. In order to be 90-90-90, it means 90% of people are diagnosed whether they have HIV or not. That's totally lab dependent. The other 90 is the people getting on treatment, and the last 90, the outcome 90, the impact 90, is viral load. 90% virally suppressed so that they can't transmit the virus and they're virally suppressed for their own health. Extraordinary. But it's bookended by the critical importance of those laboratory assays. So we are completely dependent on the function of the laboratory. Well, what have we learned from our surveys that we put in the field? Community-based surveys, door-to-door. We've learned that the first-line drugs that you went with us to Africa to deliver and other resource-limited settings, including Haiti and Vietnam, have been amazingly durable. And so people today are still virally suppressed on those same first-line drugs. Our resistance numbers are less than 5%. But I loved it when Jane talked about how she knew what questions to ask. Our clients have stayed on their treatment when they have to go back and get their drugs every 2 weeks. They are the ones that made the effort 14 years, 10 years, 5 years later to stay on treatment. Sometimes we've made it very difficult where they have to walk long ways to clinics to find out that there's no drugs at that clinic today. And they have to come back the next day. They lose days at work. But that's how devoted our clients have been. The other thing that we've realized just in the last 12 months is that we are missing all of the men. All of the men, almost, unless they're sick. Because healthy men have not come to health centers in resource-limited settings since the beginning of the epidemic, because they see the health centers for pregnant mothers and children under five. So when we talk about strengthening the health system and strengthening the laboratory system, we have to develop the health system that men will want to go to. We have the same problem in the United States. I won't take a poll about how many men in the last 12 months have been to the doctors versus the women in the audience. I bet I will see a disparity. Because men do not interact with the healthcare delivery system. Now, we do find that men injure themselves and they will come to the healthcare delivery system, so now we're doing HIV testing in the emergency rooms. What else have we learned? We've learned that HIV isn't everywhere. And it's very interesting when you start looking, you find pockets of HIV. And this has really helped us focus resources. But as I said, the men don't know that they're infected. So they're passing the virus on, often to younger women between 15 and 24. Just to show you what this looks like in Kenya. In Kenya, almost half of the new infections last year were in 15 to 24-year-olds. So what does the epidemic look like? So this big continent, this is a cartogram. So the bigger the country, the higher burden of the disease, the darker the green, the higher the prevalence. And you can see about 72% of all of HIV is in sub-Saharan Africa. But you can see Brazil, and you can see Vietnam, and you can see the Ukraine, places we all work together. Now, what do these surveys look like? And I'm just gonna go really quickly. It's just shown us that we've had a tremendous impact on incidence of disease. Remember, PEPFAR was started as a generosity of the American people to save people's lives, so that there would be moms and dads and teachers and doctors to care for and develop the next generation, to be there in the countries where 50% of 20 to 40-year-olds were dying. And so it was a humanitarian approach, but in the end, we found out we were not only saving people's lives, we were changing the very course of the pandemic. And these are the declines in new infections, anywhere from 50 to almost 80%. We just did a repeat of a study in Swaziland. We had a baseline in Swaziland. 5 years ago, we've shown that we've decreased incidence by more than 50% just in the last 5 years. This is what's possible when the full system of the US government, along with partners like you all, come together to have this response. Prevalence is also declining. Again, Swaziland. I call your attention to the turquoise line. That's where Swaziland was 5 years ago. More than 50% of men and women were HIV positive by the time they were 30. The interesting part about this new diagram with the dark blue lines show that prevalence is declining in the earliest age groups. This is very exciting news because the group that is at the highest risk is to having lower and lower prevalence. And you can see the prevalence, the high prevalence, is shifting to the older age groups, showing that we're keeping people alive. So what does a 90-90-90 look in these first four countries? And we're now doing the survey in 15 countries, the highest burden countries. You can see across the board, now between 67 and 85% of every adult in these countries know their status. Now, I can tell you that there's not anything in the United States where 67 to 85% of us know we have it or not. This is an amazing feat. It's a feat that has to do with people coming to the clinic or coming to the mobile clinics or now even self-testing to know whether they're HIV positive or not. Of those who know that they are positive, almost anywhere between 87% and 89% are on treatment. And of those, almost 90% are virally suppressed. This is extraordinary. This is extraordinary progress. The fact that we can say that 75% of every adult in these four countries knows their status, and if they're negative, they can be referred to prevention interventions. If they're positive, they can be referred to treatment. Now, why is this important? That turquoise line is the line, and that big red line, this is Zambia. The big red line is 10% prevalence. Look when young women start to get to 10% prevalence, 20 to 24. And so we have to prevent infections at a much younger age. with a much more effective package of programs. And what else is the huge problem in sub-Saharan Africa? Is this demographic youth bulge. I like to refer to it as a wave. It's truly a wave of adolescents that will continue unrelentingly through 2050. Since the beginning of the epidemic, we now have twice as many 15 to 24-year-olds, and that will continue to rise. So you can see just in Zambia alone, there's been a 110% increase in young women and young men in the last 30 years. That's the age group that's at risk, and that's the age group that we're very much focused on with prevention, because young girls, 15 to 24, are 5 to 14 times more likely to become HIV infected. So what do we know about the disease now? We know that young men between 23 and 35 infect young women between 16 and 23, and they go on, not knowing what their serostatus is, to infect their male partners. And that cycle just continues. So what have we been doing? So we launched this really exciting new prevention initiative called DREAMS, Determined, Resilient, Empowered, AIDS-Free, Mentored, and Safe Young Women, recognizing that it had to be a multi-component structural intervention to keep young women HIV negative. We are trying desperately to find the 25 to 35-year-old young men who are healthy and have no reason to interact with the health center. And that's been a real challenge. And then we're looking for the men before they become positive and doing circumcision and other interventions that we know will keep them from getting positive. Now, when I showed you that slide that we had tested 75% of the adult population, it was quite inspirational. But when you look at who we are missing, it is not the 10%, it's the 60%, because we've tested about 95% of all the women and less than 50% of the men. And if you're under 35, less than 30%. So Swaziland has this new graphic. The other thing that we're working desperately on, and you all have done it so well when walking the booths, is how to visualize data in a way that becomes actionable, and that a program manager can immediately look and see where's the problem, and is what they're doing changing the problem and part of the solution. This is Swaziland. That green part that you see are the number of men who are positive but don't know their status. You can see how tiny that purple area is for young women and older women. This is the way Namibia looks at it. The turquoise are the number of people who have HIV but don't know their status. And you can see it's a huge number in the younger age groups. This is Uganda's cascade of number of people living with HIV, who knows they're positive, are they on treatment, are they virally suppressed. This is for children. And we've done really a much better job with children, but this is 15 to 24-year-olds. And you can see they're less virally suppressed and less of them know their status. This is if you're over 25. Now, what does that mean in the end? So this is another graphic. This is the country, men and women. The yellow means that you're not significantly virally suppressed in that district. So at a glance, they can see where their problems are. So this is individuals over 25 years old, men and women. Look at what happens if I just graph by district under 25. You see now we have a sea of red and yellow because people don't know their status. So we need a new approach to testing. I wanted to let you know that we're very conscious about cost of testing. Door-to-door testing costs almost $900 to find a positive. That is not sustainable for any country anywhere around the globe. So we're looking at ways to get people to come to us rather than us going to them. And this will be a really important work over the next few years. We're also working across the board with improving partner performance around key areas. This is the partner performance in the Democratic Republic of Congo. This is the partners that we're providing. These are very sophisticated partners. They would be very well known to you all. I blanked them out with that red box so you couldn't tell who those partners were. This is TB clients tested for HIV put on treatment. So if you know TB clients are getting directly observed treatment, they're in the clinic every day, it should be easy to test them. But you can see there's those size of the circles are the number of clients who were seen and not tested. So you can see that large circle at the bottom towards the middle, 50% of clients with TB were not tested for HIV. In just 2 quarters, 6 months, all of those clients and all of those sites are now above 80%. This is what can happen when you look at data at a site level. Because of the work that we've been doing collectively, and I was really excited to hear about utilizing fax scans for diagnosing children's leukemia, because we're working very hard on ensuring that every child has access to treatment, because HIV AIDS is devastating to young children, and many of them, 50%, die before their fifth birthday. So now, just in the last 2 years for accelerating children's treatment, we've doubled the number of children treated, and this is really the communities coming forward with the children to ensure that they're diagnosed. And so for the first time in the history of HIV/AIDS in resource-limited settings, you can see that the orange bars are as high as the blue bars, which are the adults, in access to treatment. So it's not just about the laboratory, it's about the health system that allows the samples to come to the laboratory, and it's about the community trusting the clinic and trusting the laboratory. Many of you have worked with us on improving laboratories over the last 14 years. That is why I could talk about 3/4 of the adult population knowing their status. That's why I could talk about the accessibility of CD4 and viral load. And many of you helped us make the case about why laboratory systems had to be improved. And we have picture after picture of the work that you've done in improving just the physical infrastructure in laboratories in low-cost ways, and giving technicians safe areas to work, like this biosafety cabinet. And then really looking at availability of SOPs and data and laboratory information systems. And finally, creating that laboratory network, which is so key to success, to understand what should be done at the health post, what should be done at the health clinic, what should be done at this district hospital, what should be done at the regional hospital. And really the role that you have played in the pre-analytic, the analytic, and the post-analytic phase, and the way you have helped us with SLAMTA, which was a stepwise accreditation. When you're here, and you have to go here for quality, if you don't have steps of being able to see your progress, it's very difficult to make those changes. And you can see there's picture after pictures of lab before and lab after, and the pride that our laboratorians have taken in that professionalism. So I just want to conclude about issues of leapfrogging and innovation and bringing the newest technology that is often more effective and more efficient, whether it's our work with Pink Ribbon, Red Ribbon about cervical cancer and HPV diagnosis, whether it's our work with AstraZeneca in improving hypertension diagnosis, to really ensure that we're not only strengthening the lab system for HIV, but in a horizontal way. And we're very excited about the African CDC and John Nkengasong and his leadership and how we can work better together. So I just want to conclude with a couple of key points. We really need an assay that tells when people were infected so that we can continue to track how the epidemic continues to evolve and who are the new risk groups and how we treat them. Continue to work on partner performance, but ensuring that viral load is available not just to the clinician and the nurse, but to the client. Figuring out a way that the information that we have immediately goes to clients' analog phones or smartphones so that they have the data that we have. Because I started with, and I want to finish with, our greatest gift to this program has been you all and the people that we serve. Because they have been the ones, and you have been the ones, that have pushed us forward and made the program better. And we need to continue to innovate, both for the clients that we serve and for the systems that we need to ensure that all of these are available. So I'm just going to, so that we are on time, stop there and just, again, thank you where I started. Thank you for the volunteers and the work, and they're willing to give of yourself and your knowledge to create a better place for everybody in sub-Saharan Africa and in resource-limited settings. Thank you.
Please welcome back to the stage Dr. Holliver.
Great job. It's nice to see you. Well, thank you, Dr. Birx. We're going to have an opportunity just to have a casual conversation with some panel experts, including our very own Dr. Birx, as well as several of our members of our team at ASCP. We all share your vision, the vital role that laboratory plays in bringing sustainable solutions around the world. So let me first start off by introducing somebody that most of you know very well. This is our Chief Officer for Science, Technology, and Policy, Jeff Jacobs. Jeff joined the Society in 2003. He's worked on the domestic front. He's worked on the international front. He's worked with PEPFAR. In fact, he was the liaison to the ASCP for the PEPFAR program. And Jeff was the Associate Executive Director at the Association for Public Health Laboratories before he joined us at ASCP. He currently provides oversight and direction for science, technology, policy for our ASCP Institute, and our new initiative, which is our evidence-based initiative, the National Pathology Quality Registry, which is poised to transform the way we all practice medicine. Please welcome Jeff Jacobs to the stage. Our panel also includes Chief Medical Officer Dan Milner, who joined the Society a year ago. He was previously at Harvard Medical School in Boston, where he held the position of Associate Professor of Pathology in the Department of Immunology and Infectious Diseases at Harvard H.T. Chang School. He currently provides oversight and direction for all medical aspects of ASCP's program, our policies related to global health. Please welcome Dr. Dan Milner. All right, let's have a little fun here, shall we? I promised the panel that some things they might know and may not know all of them, but we're going to have a little fun up here. So strap on your seatbelt and let's go. We'll start with Dr. Birx. So some of the experts, including some in the audience, have said in the next 4 years, there's going to be an inflection point in terms of HIV treatment, and such that there's going to be a dramatic decrease in the disease. Do you agree with that forecast, or what's your opinion on that?
I think, you know, what I didn't talk about is how much science has advanced. And when, I don't know, many of you know Dr. Fauci, but I trained in Dr. Fauci's laboratory 30-some years ago when we were working on Wegener's granulomatosis before HIV. And he, 5 years ago, said, we have the tools to control the pandemic. It's up to you to implement those tools in a way. So we have the science. And I think what reason we're doing those surveys now is we have to prove to ourselves and to the global community that HIV/AIDS can be controlled. Now, can it be eliminated or eradicated? No, not without a vaccine or a cure. But it can be controlled. And I think we are showing now the evidence base of how much it's being controlled. Now, some people will say the number of new infections has stagnated. And that is true. But that's in the face of 3 to 4% additional people that would be susceptible to disease every year because of that youth bulge. So the fact that the numbers are steady is huge, and in a whole series of countries, they're going down. And we have new drugs now. We have a new drug called DTG. And I just want to thank pharma for making licensures available so that new drugs, as they're available in the US, the licensures go to generic companies to make those drugs available for resource-limited settings. So I'm excited, but it's all about us implementing faster. So a lot of people say it's a marathon, but I think, you know, it's time to, you know, Usain Bolt retired, so now we can all take his place and run that 100 quicker.
I think it was 4 or 5 years ago, former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton developed the blueprint for creating an AIDS-free generation. You recall that, and you were instrumental in that particular roadmap. And the roadmap was to bring better planning, better health systems, better science, better technology, all these things to the countries. But we haven't really heard much about that blueprint in the past year or so since the new administration stepped in. Do you have any information for us you can share with us?
So the new administration, I think you've heard in their testimonies how supportive they are of PEPFAR. For one thing, they knew what PEPFAR was, which is always exciting when your Secretary of State, who's dealing with really extraordinary issues around the globe, and this administration is dealing with extraordinary issues, can talk about PEPFAR and can talk about it in a very real way. Our Secretary of State now believes so much in the progress that we've made. He tasked us to build off the blueprint and write a strategy in 13 countries to actually show that we can control the pandemic and decrease the out-year costs within the next 3 years. And so I think this is a challenge for all of us. I also want to make it clear, he's preserving our services in the other countries. Because sometimes I know that 13 got confusing to people, but he wants us to accelerate the strategy very much in conjunction with the basic premises of the blueprint and accelerate that strategy to actually show that you can control the pandemic and decrease the out-year costs. So we're excited about the challenge. PEPFAR has never failed, and I certainly don't want to be part of the leadership that for the first time doesn't really show that we can come through when a really senior political smart individual says we can do it.
And in fact, I think your point is very good around our current administration being nonpartisan around one of the most important, as we mentioned earlier, the biggest impact factor on healthcare that's occurred outside our own country, and that is to support patients who need treatment for HIV. Jeff, you've been in D.C., what, 30 years now?
30 years.
30 years, and in those 30 years, you've seen the policies ebb and flow. You've seen administrations come and go. You've seen activities throughout a lot of the federal government's branches. What's your perspective in terms of the future for, well, let's just say, funding related to the kinds of activities on HIV diagnosis, or even for that matter, beyond HIV? What's your thoughts?
Well, let me start by just saying that I'm very inspired by Dr. Birx's presentation today because it shows the progress that we've made. If you go back 30, 35 years, obviously when this epidemic first came on the horizon, it was a difficult time. It was difficult to understand. I think it was difficult for scientists to explain the current state and what we needed to do to address the epidemic. So I think it took us a little time to get our sea legs to start moving, to start going in the right direction. But I've been very impressed by the bipartisan nature of addressing this epidemic. I think we can be very proud of all of the administrations who've been in place since this epidemic began. And I'm very, very encouraged to hear Dr. Birx talk about the current administration and the great work that we can do going into the future.
So you're a glass half full guy, huh?
I think the glass is more than half full.
All right.
I think we're on the
75% road.
There we go. We got it.
Dan, so you've been in this space for a while. Obviously, you're a public health expert. You're an infectious disease pathologist. You're an anatomic pathologist. You have seen atrocities throughout Africa. You've spent a lot of time in the field, and you know that, of course, HIV is simply, again, as we mentioned, the inflection point for other diseases as well. Think outside of HIV. What has PEPFAR done to help us at least build upon the opportunity for other disease monitoring and prevention outside of HIV? How did it set the stage for us?
Well, I think you have to look at the fact that in order to be successful in PEPFAR in any country, you had to have essentially every patient in that country have access to laboratory diagnostics. And as anybody in this room can tell you, a sample for HIV or a sample for thyroid testing or a sample for a cancer biomarker is just a sample that we get from one place to the other, we perform our test, and we get you that result back. So I think the infrastructure that's been built, and you look at the example of the Uganda, used to be called the Central Public Health Laboratory, now it's called the Ugandan Public Health Laboratory Service, 119 lab hubs that can get a sample from anywhere in a country of 55 million to Kampala within a week and get a diagnosis, has already trained all of those hubs to do histology-related biopsies and get those to a central hub. That's the kind of legacy that I think PEPFAR is really leaving for other diseases, is that infrastructure where we can easily overlay other diseases and the needs that we have to take care of those diseases as successfully as we have with HIV.
So what are you doing to help us with that?
What am I doing to help us with that?
You.
So every time I get a chance, I say, look at Uganda and the HIV. So I think it's really important to reiterate to the leadership of PEPFAR, to reiterate to the leadership of this country, to the leadership of other countries, that the value, the solid gold that they have sitting in front of them with what PEPFAR has given them, and how they should build upon that and create an industrial complex of healthcare rather than using that siloed approach that we've used for so long. And so advocating for that, I think, is really important. We've picked, the Partners Cancer Initiative has really picked all cancers, but we recognize that our partners are looking at individual cancers. We work with them, but then we say, all right, what are we gonna do about this cancer and this cancer? So I think you have to keep advocating at all times for the laboratory, the role of the laboratory, but also make people aware of what they have in front of them and how valuable it is, and that you don't have to reinvent the wheel. You have what you need. You just need this one more SOP or this one more process to get it done.
And it's sometimes difficult to fathom that when you go outside the boundaries of this country and you talk to ministries of health and you talk to change agents like Dr. Birx, and you work with folks who really don't care about the partisan politics of the United States and how it affects our country, but what we can do to spread and help the message and bring the kinds of sustainable systems. It really is a very distant system of thinking, because these folks, oftentimes, they come to the table and they simply think about, this is the greatest country on earth, and we have the properties and the opportunities and the potential to share our wealth and resources. And they expect us to continue to do that. Dr. Birx, has that been your experience as well when you're in the field?
You know, I think what I've been really excited about, I recognize when I don't have expertise, and I got very confused in talking to ministers of finance. They just talk a very different language. So we brought in our U.S. Department of Treasury, who knows how to talk to ministries of finance and make the business cases. And I think since we've done that, they've been very effective in making that business case that an investment in health is an investment in their people that would allow their GNP to increase, rather than, because it's always trade-offs.
Right.
And they're always having to make those decisions. And I think I've been very impressed. Now, our problem has been, we know what we spent, but we don't know what it should cost. And we cannot hand over programs to governments that are inflated in their cost. And that's the other thing, the governments see when we're inefficient. I'll never forget, I was at a table, we were drinking wine, and we were meeting with the ministers of health, all were, you know, I was feeding them dinner and drinking wine, so I could see what was going on. And the permanent secretary from Zambia said, you know, we thought the Americans were just so rich that they didn't care how much money they were wasting. Mm. And that, I had the same reaction. I was like, thank goodness I hadn't been drinking, because boy, that's a very frightening concept. Because they can see when our partners are wasting money. And they can see when we're not doing it in the most effective and efficient way. They won't criticize us,
right,
but they know that's going on.
Right.
And so that's really our job over the next 4 years, as we decrease the amount of HIV/AIDS, to also really ensure that we know what things cost, so we can be very, very clear to ministers of finance what the out-year cost of the program is really going to be. And then I think, like South Africa, like Namibia, like Botswana, like Swaziland, they have all doubled, tripled, quadrupled their investment because they can see this kind of progress.
Absolutely. So several years ago, we began working with Paul Farmer through, of course, our work with the Clintons. And then the next step was to look at how we could drill down on specific diseases. And most of the audience know that PEPFAR really emanated from the Bush administration. It was President Bush's dream to bring change in an emerging part of the world where the economy is growing the fastest, yet patients didn't have access to diagnostics. And that was a Herculean effort by President Bush. But the next step was his work with Pink Ribbon, Red Ribbon. And he and Laura Bush, who spoke on this several years ago when we were in Boston, have made a tremendous imprint. And Dr. Birx has been instrumental in helping guide that mission and help with the cervical cancer, breast cancer initiative in many of these countries. Jeff sits at the table with these folks, and helps them make the appropriate policy decisions. It's a wonderful, wonderful initiative. Tell us a little bit more about your experience with Pink Ribbon, Red Ribbon, and where it's headed, and some of the impact that's been made, Dr. Birx. And Jeff, please.
Well, you know, it's always fascinating to me to interact with presidents, because you would think that they wouldn't have the level of detail and you could just say things. No, they have an amazing level of detail. And I think and many people know that PEPFAR grew out of his prevention of mother-to-child transmission that he started in 2001 and realized he was saving the babies and their mothers were dying, and said we had to be better, and started PEPFAR. Then he went back to Africa and was confronted in a clinic, because he always interacts with the individuals in all of the clinics, and the woman said, I've been on treatment for 6 years, I was saved from HIV, and I'm dying from cervical cancer, because it's not that they have a higher incidence, they have a higher incidence of a more aggressive form of cervical cancer. And their precancerous lesions don't revert back to normal. That often happens with HIV negative. And they have been an extraordinary force, because these are policy changes that countries have to take on to have these programs work. I mean, they're providing the human capacity to make these programs work. So he's been all over sub-Saharan Africa again, really generating that political will. And it's political will combined with people that makes change happen. And I think it's really been extraordinary to watch his legacy, watch President Obama continue to support the program, and then watch President Trump pick up where the others have left off, and the Congress continuing to fund us. And right. So it's a blessing every day, but with that comes a burden that you have to be better with all of these programs so that you can really realize the dream that I think all three of those presidents have, and that's an AIDS-free future for the world.
So Dr. Birx, it's been a real honor to sit at that table with you and to watch you work that virtuoso, magic that you can work. And one of the things that I wanted to ask you is that the Pink Ribbon, Red Ribbon campaign has really been focused on specific countries where you believe you can address breast and cervical cancers. And I want to know what how you choose those strategies that you choose for countries like Botswana, for countries like Zambia, for Ethiopia. So if you could help us understand the strategy that you've helped guide with the Pink Ribbon, Red Ribbon.
You know, there's one thing about President Bush, and he doesn't want to do things to feel good. He wants to do things to see an impact. And so he was not going to ever be satisfied by a pilot program. So we had to find countries where there was political will to take these interventions to scale. And we're talking about 9 million women, 7 million women that need to be screened. So, you know, it was really going into countries where there was that political will to take the program to scale, because a pilot is never going to get us to the impact that we want to have. And I think that's what the thrilling piece about Pink Ribbon, Red Ribbon is. I think we're looking very carefully about the Pink Ribbon piece and really understand that. And I think we're excited about the leukemia piece, because I think it's once countries can see that they can afford that, you know, these are great visuals to really then not be so frightened by cancer. The stigma with cancer is as bad as it is with HIV. It keeps people from the clinic. It keeps their children from the clinic. And so I think the work that we'll do together with cervical and breast cancers creates, again, that platform, not only of political will, but of community understanding about cancer, and it can be treated. It is not a plague on the family. It is not a curse put on them for something that someone did in the past. It is it's a medical issue that can be addressed.
Your point about the fact that they roll up their sleeves and are experts is incredible. You're absolutely right. You know, several years ago we had Bill Clinton speak, and he blew me away with just the level of detail that he would go into and the technicalities about the laboratory. And the man didn't want to know what I was going to ask him. So I got to say that the good news is that our presidents do have a life after their presidency. And they bind together, don't they? In fact, the Bush and Clinton often travel together to bring changes and to promote their programs, et cetera. And it is a a legacy. It's a fiduciary responsibility to our country.
And the first ladies.
Exactly.
So when Laura Bush and Michelle Obama were on the stage together,
right,
every first lady in the audience was astounded because they couldn't believe that first ladies from two different parties would actually sit there and talk about their children and going to school, because usually first ladies are ostracized when there's another first lady. So it was really, it's not only a medical and health
That's
issue,
correct.
It's really a democracy and governance issue to really show how people get along in and out of politics.
The first ladies, in fact, obviously have a tremendous interest in breast and cervical cancer. In fact, they're some of the biggest influencers, aren't they? Dan, we were recently at a meeting with the CGH, the Clinton Global Initiative, and they brought all the Caribbean first ladies to the table to discuss how they're going to shepherd these programs throughout the Caribbean. Don't you see this when you're in your travels as well, Dan, and how they are the change makers, so to speak?
Absolutely. At the UICC meeting in Paris, the reception that was held, the first ladies were there. They wanted to talk to us about pathology, and they were talking about breast cancer and cervical cancer and other, you know, women's cancers, et cetera, and how they can protect their women. And many of the leaders in UICC are very strong advocates in their own countries. In fact, I think the current president of UICC is Her Highness from
right,
Jordan,
right.
who started an amazing program in her own country, which started with women's cancers, but has expanded to really all cancers, and has a premier cancer center based on that. So you have to start somewhere, and I think, you know, just like with HIV, Dr. Birx was referring to in her talk, where the women and the children are the ones that come to clinic, you know, the women are the ones that come with breast cancer because it's disfiguring, it's embarrassing, they don't know what to do, and they're dying from it, and once you get them to be advocates and get them to be survivors and get them out there, then the men eventually will show up to the clinic as well, and you can actually build out a comprehensive program. But I think it always, I mean, in the 1980s in South Africa, it was a women's advocate group that was saying, why aren't you sending us HIV drugs today to Africa? You know, it's you know, there's power in voices, and I think they have the right voices to get this change made.
Okay, Dan, close your eyes. Now imagine this audience. You have two or three of the biggest funders of global health in the world. Okay? What are you going to ask them? What are you going to do? How are you going to help them help you?
Give me $50 million. 5 million a year over the next 10 years, and I will put 20 to 30 pathology labs in Africa per year, and we'll solve cancer in a decade.
And what, there you go. And let's hope we get the Gates Foundation to support all this as well.
That's what my grant application says. So we'll see.
All right. We need to wrap this down. And then we're going to have a special celebration here. But before we do, I'm going to end it on this. So somebody once said that a dream that you dream alone is just a dream. But a dream you dream together is a reality. Who said it?
Willy Wonka.
Wrong. Dr. Birx, any?
I don't know. I was really good in math and science, but not great in English at all.
Okay, Jeff, do you know?
I'm in trouble. No, I don't.
He said, give peace a chance.
John
and that
Lennon.
Was the immortal John Lennon. Thank you very much for all of you, your attention, and please give them a round of applause. Jeff? Dan, yeah, you can.
My privilege to present to Dr. Birx the 2017 ASCP Patient Advocate Award in recognition of your leadership to change the course of HIV/AIDS in the United States and throughout the world. Ambassador Birx's three-decade-long career has focused on HIV/AIDS, immunology, vaccine research, and global health. In 2011, she led the U.S. government through PEPFAR and UNAIDS to join with President Bush, Mrs. Laura Bush, and the George W. Bush Institute to found Pink Ribbon and Red Ribbon, a public-private partnership that catalyzes the global community to provide access to prevention and treatment services for breast and cervical cancers. Prior to her work with CDC, Ambassador Birx, a proud Army veteran, having risen to the rank of colonel in the United States Army, served at the Department of Defense as director of the U.S. Military HIV Research Program at the Walter Reed Institute of Research. She also served as Assistant Chief of Hospital Immunology Service at Walter Reed Army Medical Center. And as we heard, she is currently the Ambassador at Large to the United Nations and Coordinator of the United States Government Activities to Combat HIV/AIDS and U.S. Special Representative for Global Health Diplomacy. Dr. Birx.
You surprised me. Thank you. Thank you. It means a lot thank coming you so from much. You and the work you've done.
Well, thank you. You so much.
Thank you.
Please. Okay. Thank you.
One more.
With your leadership, how awesome. Pick up that global health brochure and get excited.
Thank you so much. Okay, I'd like to introduce our esteemed president, President Schreiber. Please come to stage, if you would, for an announcement. In fact, it's going to be a special announcement. There he is, please. Now, I promise our president, before his presidential speech, he wouldn't have to give his first words, but how about this event? Is it amazing?
Pretty impressive.
Incredible. Okay. Well, we have an exciting announcement for you. ASCP was just informed that we've received a major gift to the foundation from BioReference Laboratories for $50,000. And this gift is going to be used to promote the value of laboratory to patients, payers, to the government, other healthcare professionals, and BioReference Laboratories is a multinational diagnostic company working to establish industry-leading positions in medical markets through discovery, development, commercialization, novel technologies, point-of-care diagnostics, novel molecular diagnostics, and proprietary pharmaceuticals and vaccines that make a difference. And I would like to introduce the president and CEO of BioReference Laboratories, Dr. Henderson, to please join us on the stage and thank him. And there you go. Please. It's a large check. We're going to share this partnership more over the next few months with you, and you'll see BioReference Laboratories represented as our major partner. We look for their continuous generous donations, and this is an organization that cares about the future, and our friend and president and CEO actually would like to have a few words with us, if you don't mind. Yeah, please, Greg.
So Blair, I was sitting in the audience reflecting on what I wanted to say to you and to the organization, because I didn't really know what I was going to say, and it came to me. And I realized there's a lot of good karma on this stage right there. Do you know that? Do you remember?
There is.
So 10 years ago today, almost to the day, the ASCP invited me to give this keynote speech on the opening day to reflect upon my experiences in Hurricane Katrina, and also to announce and strongly advocate for all of the work that the ASCP had been doing in the international arena. It was one of the finest moments of my life. I was more proud to be asked to do that than practically anything else in my life. To realize as I sat on the chairs, like, wow, it's been 10 years to the day almost. that now I stand here on this stage and find myself in the astounding, honorable position to be able to lead BioReference Laboratories, to take a very solid organization and refocus it on becoming truly the force for good in the world that we believe needs to be a force for good for laboratory professionals and for pathologists, and to lead that way. And to realize that the circle has come full, and that part of being that change that we so believe and we live and breathe in our organization is about becoming a true partner in the initiatives and with the organizations that really are doing that change, and that is the ASCP. So it is an even greater honor to stand here and be able to present this to you on behalf of our company.
Thank you, Dr. Henderson. Be careful inserting this into the ATM machine. Okay.
Your brother.
All right.
Thanks, man.
So the ASCP Foundation provides all of us an opportunity to advance diagnostic medicine. Thanks for his generous gift. Please stop by our booth to make a donation, whether it's $20 or $2,000. We ask you to please help us change tomorrow. And you can even buy raffle tickets. We have those available for you. There's a lot of great prizes that we're going to be giving away as part of this as well. So before we proceed across the hall for our housekeeping, just have a couple of announcements. First of all, I want to thank the American Proficiency Institute for sponsoring this general session. Dan Ensign has been a long-term crucial partner for ASCP. We thank you, Dan. We have several grant-funded sessions as well tomorrow that we don't want you to miss. One of them is the ROS session supported by Pfizer, which takes place at 7:30 tomorrow morning in Grand B. The Merck IO grant session or immuno-oncology session will take place tomorrow at 9:45 in Grand B. And then the Cleveland Clinic industry workshop will also be held tomorrow. AstraZeneca's satellite symposium will be Friday morning in the Plaza Ballroom. And we'd also like to extend our special gratitude for our partners, our MOU partners with the Society for Hematopathology and the European Association for Hematopathology for holding their annual meeting in conjunction with ASCP, which is the Molecular Genetic Hematolymphoid Neoplasm. And we're going to be continuing to celebrate our work with them over the next several days. So don't miss tomorrow's session lastly. Tomorrow's session is the right diagnosis through advanced analytics with Dr. Michael Calgary, as well as Colin Pritchard, right here, 11:30, in this room. It's going to be another amazing event, and our president is going to give us his address as well about the future of our profession. Finally, let's do it. Across the hall, in the exhibit hall, we have a wonderful evening awaiting you. Let's have a blast and meet and greet, and let's advance the future. Thank you all for coming.